Thank you, Dr. Kimmins, for your kind remarks, and thanks to ACTEAZ for the opportunity to speak to you today. And of course, thanks to all of you who are listening for the exceptional work that you continue to do during these most trying times. You make a difference. It's probably fitting that an Irish fellow with a name like Mulcahy would be chosen to speak at a conference entitled Find Your Pot of Gold. Not only am I Irish, with my parents' clans hailing from both the Republic of Ireland and Northern Ireland, but the story of the pot of gold is one I was frequently told as a child. My mother would tell it often as she needed to teach me some life lesson. Of course, the moral of the story would always change a little bit as my behavior evolved and she felt the need to point out some particular character lesson to me, and I needed many of those. Of all the Irish myths that exist, and there are many, the story of leprechauns and their pot of gold seems to have infiltrated American culture the most. You can't go anywhere around St. Patrick's Day without seeing a poster of rosy-cheeked, red-haired fairies sliding down rainbows into cauldrons of gold. The most well-known story of the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, the version I was told most frequently, involves a couple of poor farmers in Ireland. When this husband and wife pulled their very last carrot out of the garden, they found a leprechaun dangling from the roots. Being captured, the leprechaun promised one wish in exchange for his freedom. The husband and wife could not decide on just a single wish, so they began wishing for everything, new tools, a new house, new jewelry. And the list continued until the leprechaun interrupted them. Dismayed by their greed, the leprechaun told the couple they might have all they wished for and more if they could find his pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. The leprechaun winked and left the farmers to chase rainbows forever, looking for a fictitious fortune. The cautionary tale, this one in particular, reminds us that relying on luck and magic can be a recipe for disaster. Instead of working hard, as I was taught to do, and making strategic moves to build financial stability, people can be tricked into wasting their precious time and resources searching for a pot of gold at the end of a rainbow. But let me assure you, my friends, there is a pot of gold. And today we're going to talk about how we can find it and how we can help students to do the same. But first of all, let's look back on the last 12 months. Who could have predicted the year that was 2020 and beyond, and who would have believed you if you did? More than 90% of schools worldwide shut down. Restaurants shuttered, and professional sports were canceled or postponed, God forbid. Now, as you know, I'm rather fond of research, so I've attempted to chart some trends from the last 12 months. Let's see if any of my research rings true with you. Well, here we go. First off, let's look at the trends around the wearing of a certain undergarment. It appears that there was a rather precipitous decline in that February-March time, and my wife has confirmed this. Let's look at coffee consumption. Well, that was fairly steady. I can tell you it was in our office. Car usage? Well, this too dropped off steadily at the beginning of the pandemic, and largely as many of us began to work from home, and you know what happened to teaching. And then there was the internet usage. The parents in the group will remember this as they struggled to find more broadband to accommodate all those kids learning from home. And then shaving, there was quite a decline here. And my research suggests that it was true for men and women. Alcohol consumption? I probably don't need to say much about this, except that the companies making alcoholic beverages had a most profitable year. And then there was toilet paper, one of the strangest phenomenons of 2020. Check out that trend. And then, of course, there was the wearing of masks. This was a tough one to chart, but here it is. Such was the year that was 2020 and beyond. I suspect that many of you, like me, had your favorite meme. I looked at lots of them and got lots of laughs. Here was my favorite from 2020. Yeah, yes, a nice cup of 2020. It's kind of the modern day version of a sharp stick in the eye. But as entertaining as that was, perhaps one of the pieces that I liked the most was one that made the rounds in the early days of online teaching on social media. You may have seen it. If not, I urge you to enjoy this news piece now.
Continues on in isolation, people working from home, they're trying to figure out things to do with their family, things to figure out how to pass the time. Yeah. Lindsay and Kels, a lot of teachers have been going online and coaches trying to help out their students and their athletes. This one teacher in particular, music teacher, I thought was phenomenal. Not only did she pick up an instrument and decide to help out her student and spread some joy, but she wrote a song, and as inspiration, she was going to share what she's been going through and how it makes her feel. Sure. While she is in isolation. Have a look.
Hey, so as some of you guys might know, I'm a music teacher, and I found that one of the best ways that I can process the whole transition to online learning and teaching is to write a song. So I wrote a song. I'd like to share that with you guys now. Here we go.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I hope that you're laughing. Sometimes it's our only alternative to crying. But please know, I do not in any way mean to make light of the tragedy that was also 2020 and beyond. I know that many of you lost loved ones to COVID-19, and my heart goes out to you. Tens of millions of individuals across our planet were made ill by COVID, and some 500,000 have died. It is a worldwide tragedy. And 2020 was made challenging not only by COVID, but by other heartbreaking events as well. Racial unrest is at a high point, not seen in Gallup polls since they began collecting data over 20 years ago. And who could have predicted the climate-related disasters? There were $16 billion in damage in the U.S. alone. It was a year unlike any other in our lifetime. But before we dive deeper into the effects of that year on our economy and our broader society, let's remind ourselves about the silver lining in the pandemic, particularly in online education. Because, you know, that's what we do as educators. We always look for hope where others see despair. Well, what did we learn during the pandemic? First off, we learned that we can innovate and that we can do so on short notice. Many of you had but a weekend or maybe 5 days to go from in-person instruction to online instruction, and you did it well. The second thing we learned is that we don't need a committee. We still need to collaborate, but we don't necessarily need to have a committee sit down and meet for several years before a change is made. This proves Ben Franklin's maxim that out of adversity comes opportunity. Well, let's see how we did in terms of our innovation. And in the interest of time, I'm just going to highlight a few districts, but please know that I know these innovations occurred across the state of Arizona. Well, let's go to Taliesin. First off, in Taliesin, they did some wonderful things in culinary arts by building and distributing instructional kits for students. They sent home dry ingredients, and then the students did their cooking and baking in their own kitchens while a teacher observed and offered advice virtually. And I know this occurred across Arizona. In engineering, they sent home the materials for simple machines and friction kits. And again, students completed the labs, that hands-on learning, in their very homes. In medical assisting and sports medicine, first aid kits, splints, wraps, bandages, stethoscopes, blood pressure cuffs, and more were sent home. And again, students completed that hands-on learning at home. And the neat thing was that the transportation department got involved and distributed these kits to all of the students. In Lake Havasu, great things happening there as well. Eighth grade students are receiving videos of all their CTE programs and a list of aligned courses. And of course, the good news here is not only are those eighth grade students watching these videos and learning about CTE, but their parents are there, and their grandparents, and their brothers, and their sisters. So lots of good people are being made ambassadors for career and technical education. Teachers are staying better connected than ever with stakeholders and with one another via Zoom, as those just-in-time meetings occur effortlessly. And students here too are receiving take-home kits to ensure technical skill development. In Deer Valley, they're conducting virtual internships to ensure that work-based learning occurs. They'll have virtual advisory council meetings. They've even had a virtual career fair. And then, in order to keep those school-based enterprises functioning, they're doing curbside pickup for culinary delights and more. Innovation at its finest. And of course, our community colleges are innovating as well. And as one example, let's look at a few things the Maricopa community colleges are doing. They front-loaded the curriculum, as many of us did, with the theory, so that as students returned in smaller groups, they could get right to that hands-on instruction. The colleges have also worked with the community to assist those who are out of work, working specifically with Arizona at Work to provide the training needed to get students and the community back in the economy. In addition, they have done some innovative things with esports, a competitive gaming platform, by providing opportunities for both students and the community to get connected. And several community colleges are collaborating to offer very specific short-term trainings to enable people to obtain the credentials they need in order to get back to work. Again, Arizona innovation. And as an example of a CTED, would point out to you that at WestMEC, our recruiters are using GoPros to go out and to conduct industry tours and site tours, as well as tours of our various programs, a great way for students to learn what we have to offer. And then in addition to that, a very innovative assessment being occurring in our auto programs is the students are tuning in kind of like Teladoc, where a customer tunes in, shares their screen so that the student in our auto program can listen to what's happening with the customer's car and see what's happening and offer advice. It's a great way to have a performance-based assessment. And then in addition to that, WestMEC has brought in more speakers than ever virtually. It's just a great way to go. It's innovation, Arizona style. Well, congratulations to all of you on your innovation and your collaboration. You have proven what we have long known. CTE educators are the best of the best. But let us turn our attention now to the impact of COVID on our broader society. Within the first 3 months of COVID-19, over 40 million, a staggering number of individuals in the US filed for unemployment, with job losses reported in all sectors. As of July 2020, the unemployment rate hovered stubbornly at 13%. And even as of this recording, unemployment is hovering at 6.7%. Remember, it was below 3.5% before the pandemic. Nearly 7.7 million workers under the age of 30 were unemployed, and 3 million dropped out of the labor force by May of 2020. The unemployment rate for young adults also indicates a racial discrepancy, with Black and Latinos suffering the most. There is a theme here, and that theme is that the young and people of color were hurt most of all by the pandemic-prompted recession. The pandemic cast a huge spotlight on inequities already existing in our society. A particular interest to the high school CTE educators in the audience is the impact of COVID on teenagers. The unemployment rate for teenagers aged 16 to 19 hit 31.9% in April of 2020, the highest it has ever been in over 70 years. Again, the young suffered disproportionately. The COVID-19 recession that began in March 2020 has had a disparate effect on workers, depending on many factors: industry, occupation, level of education, parental status, race, gender. For example, declines in employment have been the largest for workers of color and those with less formal education. Such disproportionate effects owe in large part to the fact that those groups are overrepresented in the industries that have been particularly hard hit by the COVID recession. For example, significant reductions in business travel and in-person activities had led to permanent closures across the leisure and hospitality industry. In contrast, some groups of workers, including those who have higher levels of education, and those working in some industries, including transportation and warehousing, have been largely unaffected or have been able to completely recover from the COVID recession. This graph further illustrates who was hit hardest by COVID. And we can see that it was not only leisure and hospitality, but government, education, health services, professional and business services, and more. I have said that the COVID recession cast a spotlight on inequities already existing in our society, and that is certainly true, as you have already seen. This graph reminds us that not only did COVID cast a spotlight on inequities, it accelerated them. The rich got richer, and the poor got much poorer. Now, this is a difficult thing to fathom, the rich getting richer, what with the economic collapse and the surge in the ranks of the jobless, the homeless, and the hungry. But there's a whole class of people, at least the top 20% or so of earners, who've had to worry little about such matters. For them, not only has it been relatively easy to carry out their white-collar jobs from home, but the Federal Reserve's unprecedented emergency measures, including slashing benchmark rates to zero, have padded their wallets. They've refinanced their mortgages at record low rates. They've purchased second homes to get away from the cities and watched the value of their stocks and bonds and their investment accounts surge. Their massive wealth accumulation is in large part obscuring the toll felt by all those who don't enjoy the same easy access to credit or financial markets. As household net worth surged to a fresh record, hundreds of thousands of businesses are estimated to have permanently closed, putting hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people out of work. Ladies and gentlemen, income inequality in America is at the highest rate we have seen in over half a century. Again, COVID was and remains an accelerant. And even as we recover, we can see that the recovery is far more apparent for some than others. Employment for low-wage workers is still 21% below pre-pandemic levels, 21%. Again, the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. Continuing the theme, we can see that those benefiting the most from the recovery tend to be white. But the uneven distribution of the recovery is not only predicated on race, on ethnicity, on age, in education. It is a matter of gender as well, with women suffering the most. Has it ever been otherwise? Allow me to drill down now still further by summarizing where we are today. First off, the employment for the bottom quartile of American earners, those earning less than $27,000 a year, remains more than 20% below January 2020 levels, 20%. And where there is no income, there is no food. Last month, nearly 30 million adults lived in households where there was not enough to eat, up 28% from before the pandemic. And in addition to lacking money for food, there is little money for rent and mortgage payments. Over one third of adults live in households that have fallen behind on rent or mortgage payments. These are staggering statistics. And as the economy struggled and people with it, higher education suffered as well. Higher education enrollments, already hurting before COVID, are hurting even more now. But the critical point is the disproportionate effect on students coming from low-income high schools. It is another accelerant of inequality with potential long-term consequences. Not only are the poor, the people of color, the young and women harmed currently by the COVID recession, it appears that without rapid action, they will be harmed for years to come. This makes the work that our school counselors do just more important than ever, and God bless them. The burden is so largely on them to find those students who should be continuing their education and to help them to do so in a time when paying for higher education is more difficult than ever. So, my friends, why should we care? Why not dismiss all of this is the normal ups and downs of the economy? David Sigliazzo writes that widening income inequality should concern us all, as it is associated with lower economic growth for the country, higher crime rates, and increased social unrest. And haven't we seen it all? Peter Atwater of William and Mary adds, we cannot have a sustainable economy and political system where you have a small population who believe they are invincible and a growing population who feel defeated. It is in capitalism's best interest to close the gap. I would add that it is in the best interest of democracy to close the gap. But of course, there is a larger reason we should care about all of this. And I know it is a belief, a reason that all of us share. You know, in my old age, I find myself returning to things that I read as a young man and have not turned back to since. And while I am not quite as religious as I once was, I am more spiritual than ever. And as such, I have found myself rereading the oldest story known to humankind. It is a story shared by several of the great religions of the world. You'll perhaps remember the story from your childhood. It is the story of Cain and Abel. Cain and Abel, as you remember, are the first two sons of Adam and Eve. Cain, the firstborn, was a farmer, and his brother Abel was a shepherd. The brothers made sacrifices to God, each of his own produce. But God, for some reason, favored Abel's sacrifice instead of Cain's. Cain, in jealousy, murdered Abel. When God asked Cain, "Where is Abel?" Cain said he didn't know and added, "Am I my brother's keeper?" It is an important question. It has always been an important question, and now more than ever. All the great religions of the world have answered the question resoundingly in the affirmative. I am. We are our brothers and our sisters' keepers. We, particularly as educators and more especially as CT educators, are called upon to heal our society's inequities. You know, inequality is not solely some broad societal issue or a broader educational issue. It is very particularly an issue for CTE, for all of us gathered today, and for the thousands of us who work in CTE every day across Arizona. It is why equity is such an important part of Perkins 5. You know, we have work in CTE to do, to be sure that children of color and women achieve concentrator status, because we know it is only when they achieve concentrator status, when they complete CTE programs, that students are able to extract the full benefit from career and technical education. If we are to correct the inequality in our society, then all students must complete at least one pathway and obtain the associated industry credentials. To allow anything else to occur is to condemn them to a life of poverty. And with regard to education more generally, nothing illustrates better the work we have to do in achieving equity more than graduation rates. We must erase the disparity that exists between racial and ethnic groups. It is our moral obligation as educators. Well, as we know, it is our obligation, because correcting the wrongs in society has always been the job of educators. Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall reminded us over 60 years ago that every issue in society ends up at the schoolhouse door. And so it continues. So many issues that have affected society have been resolved first in schools and then later by the Supreme Court. In my lifetime, we have seen issues of racial injustice addressed and partially resolved through the desegregation of schools. We have seen the issue of a public prayer played out in schools across America, including in a few of my earliest CTSO banquets. We have addressed free speech. I remember well this particular topic around the very first Earth Day in which I participated as a young boy. We have addressed the rights of undocumented children, particularly as it affects their access to public education. We have addressed the rights of LGBTQ individuals. More recently, we have addressed the rights of transgender individuals. It is all an ongoing fight for a fairer and more equitable society. And it is our fight, not just as educators, but more specifically as CTE educators. We hold the keys to equity. As it turns out, we are the keepers of the pot of gold. Ladies and gentlemen, this we know. Research suggests that participation in CTE programs may improve students' academic and worse outcomes. A study of three states, Florida, Kentucky, and Indiana, found that earning a credential is associated with an increased likelihood of high school completion. Furthermore, participation in CTE programs increases the likelihood of community college enrollment and college completion. Students in these programs score higher on standardized tests, achieve higher GPAs, and show more progress towards graduation than comparison groups. For students taking upper-level technical skill courses, each additional year of coursework is associated with a nearly 2% increase in wages. My friends, as we know, CTE works. You know, California data show that lower income students are more likely to participate in CTE and just as likely to move on to post-secondary education and good careers. Boys and children of color in CTE are more likely to be engaged and less likely to be in trouble. CTE is the path to success, to financial stability, to entrepreneurship. It is truly the path to a more just and equitable society. And you hold the keys. We know the challenges. It is to give all students, every child in America, regardless of their race, ethnicity, gender, or sexual orientation, access to quality CTE. Every child must have the opportunity to complete a CTE program while in high school and to obtain the associated industry credentials, because we know that otherwise they will continue to suffer the ebbs and flows of our economy, just as high school graduates did in 2020, as you can see on this graph. Any student with a high school diploma alone is vulnerable. And while we should encourage students who have not participated in CTE while in high school, or those desiring additional training to participate in higher education, we must never forget that for 40% of high school students, high school is their last chance. It's the last chance for them to obtain the skills that they need for the lives that they want and deserve. To make this a reality will require that we address certain challenges in CTE and that we do so quickly. First off, we must examine the programs we are offering at the secondary and post-secondary levels and ask ourselves if they truly transport students to high-wage, high-demand occupations, those occupations that hold the highest probability of moving students to economic independence. In addition, we must ask ourselves what we can do to make sure that every student from Young to Yuma and Ganado to Gilbert can access any pathway in which they are interested. This will require innovation, the likes of which we have not yet seen, but innovation that COVID has taught us is not beyond our reach. Anything is possible when we are properly motivated, anything. And what greater motivation than the possibility that we can be the architects of a fairer and more just society. We must also make sure that post-secondary and secondary brethren together collaborate to ensure that pathways between secondary and post-secondary are seamless, and that appropriate credit for prior learning is awarded, and that we have efficient pathways that ensure the proper use of time and money and other resources. We should share advisory councils and, most importantly, a common vision for success. To do otherwise is to fail our most vulnerable populations. We must make real and lasting connections with all intermediaries in the workforce development pipeline, from workers to educators to civic groups to philanthropic organizations to political leaders to employers and more. Collaboration and the elimination of silos is key. Incidentally, when you get the chance, please read the Arizona Pipeline Educational Leadership Group report that's about to be released. You will be glad you did. And friends, we must continue the good work already underway by all of you, and most especially the CTE division at the Arizona Department of Education, to identify the most valuable industry credentials, those that truly have currency in the world of work. And finally, as CTE educators, we must ask ourselves if we are really doing all we can to prepare students for a wild new world that will see the convergence of technologies that were a few years ago the stuff of science fiction. Are we preparing students for careers that will require skills in artificial intelligence, blockchain, augmented reality, nanotechnology, machine learning, material sciences, big data analytics, and the Internet of Things, just to mention a few? If you have not yet read The World is Faster Than You Think, The World is Faster Than You Think by Peter Diamandis and Stephen Kotler, I urge you to order a copy today and to start reading it immediately. It's a wonderful, inspiring, and frightening read. Wow. Wow. What an exciting future. And what a time to work in education. Every day, each and every one of you has the honor of creating opportunity for students. But there is more to the challenge that I offer to you today. Wow. Education, and CTE in particular, are called upon to save the very fabric of our democracy. But it has always been so. The great equalizer in America is public education. It is our best chance for leveling the playing field, for giving all Americans equal opportunity to succeed. Lesser known and less appreciated is the role of CTE, but never have the stakes been higher. I told you that in my old age, I am returning to things I read as a young man and set aside. One of those items I have reread recently is the United States Constitution. I know what you're thinking, John, you need to get a life. I probably do. In the preamble, to the U.S. Constitution, it states that the first priority in forming these United States is to establish justice. Justice. And the Declaration of Independence defines justice as follows. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, chief amongst those being the pursuit of life, liberty, and happiness. We know that central to realizing these rights is obtaining a job that enables the individual to secure economic independence. CTE is truly the key to justice in America. CTE is the key to a better America. So there is gold at the end of the rainbow, and that gold is skills. And the road to acquiring those skills runs through career and technical education. And unlike gold, once acquired, it cannot be taken away. What you give students, what you give students is truly better than gold. If we can provide all students with access to quality CTE, then perhaps the most fitting song to describe the year ahead and the many years ahead is not the screamer performed by the art teacher at the beginning of this presentation, but instead this song. Thank you for listening. Thanks for all you do to make the world a better place. And remember, the answer is for CTE to take over the world.